How can you protect yourself from phishing? I work as a security consultant, I'm a professional hacker, and I wanted to tell you what you have to look out for. But before you listen to what I have to say, why don't you share in the comments what you do to not get phished? And then after the video, you can check if you do it like me. Phishing describes an attack where somebody tries to trick you to enter your login credentials on a fake website. The website might look and feel like the real website, but the actual domain is different. When entering the password here, you basically give it to the attacker voluntarily. I mean, not voluntarily, the attacker tricked you, but this is actually extremely simple to do. Every beginner web developer can do that within the first week of learning programming. It's very simple but extremely effective. Besides reusing the same password on different websites, phishing is the main risk of getting your account hacked. So how can we make sure to not fall for those tricks? How can we know if we are on a trustworthy site or on a fake phishing site? I actually already mentioned the solution. Look at what's the difference between the real website and the fake website. It's the domain. This is the most important security indicator you have. In fact, it's the only security indicator you have to determine if this is a real website or if this is a phishing website. So you have to look at the URL to find the domain. But understanding a URL is not simple. It's actually pretty hard. Even for computers, it's hard, and we expect at least them to understand it. If you are curious, I made a video once about how freaking hard is it to understand a URL. But it's a very technical video, so no need to watch it. But luckily, as a user, we don't have to go this deep into it. Even though this URL is extremely long, the browser helps us to identify the part that actually matters to us. It's the domain name here. You see that the browser is highlighting the important part with a lighter color and shows the less important part in gray. As you can tell, this is the login page from Google, and I'm using the Google Chrome browser on macOS. But you might be using a different operating system and browser. So let's look at this page and URL bar in different environments. Here, for example, is the Edge browser on Windows and an older version of Edge. As you can see, Edge does it similar to Chrome, highlighting the important domain part. But check out Firefox. They also highlight the domain, but only the main top domain. It does not include the subdomain when highlighting. But that is fine. The subdomain, so the part before this dot, is controlled by the company who controls the top part. The top part is google.com, so clearly that is safe. Maybe Firefox is helping us a bit more in this case, because to verify that you really log into google.com and not a phishing site like google.com with a zero, so this kind of tells you to generally compare from the right. This is the main part and the most important part. So now that you know that the domain is important for you to check if you are on the correct website, let's look at a browser on an iPhone, because here is something interesting. Here is Chrome and Safari. Look at this. They are completely hiding the full URL and only show you the important domain. Here you can clearly see, without getting distracted or tricked, that this is indeed google.com. So it's safe, and actually this is what Safari also does on macOS. It also hides the URL path. I know many technical people, including me, like to see the whole URL. For hacking, it's important. But to be fair, for regular users who might be super confused by the long, complex URL, only focusing on the part that matters for security, the domain, this is pretty good. Actually, recently Google was running an experiment on Chrome to also hide the URL path, like Safari, because they wanted to see if it helps with security for the general public. But after a while, they concluded that it didn't improve important security metrics. So apparently, it didn't really help to prevent more phishing. And I can see why. I think people who understand they have to look at the domain name will be fine with the highlighted version. And for those who do not understand this, they won't magically learn this from just seeing the domain. So now I think you understand where you have to look and which part of the URL is important. thanks to the browser highlighting parts of the URL, you know what the domain is. So how do we now use this knowledge to prevent phishing? It's kind of simple, but you need to be vigilant. Basically, you have to do the following. Before you type in your password, practice to always look at the domain. It doesn't matter how you got there. Maybe you clicked on a link a friend sent you. Maybe you clicked on a link on Reddit, or you clicked on a link in a phishing spam email. But before you enter your credentials, you need to look at the domain. And now you need to ask yourself, is this the correct domain? Let's do an example. So here is a login to the popular game distributor Steam, and it looks very legit. This looks like the Steam page. And if you just glance at the URL, maybe not really looking at it, it looks fine. Steam community, that is the correct domain. But we just learned that we need to be careful looking at the URL, and upon closer inspection, we see something fishy going on. It's actually not Steam, it's STRN. The small R and N look like an M at a glance. This is very tricky. And the letters are switched here, the community is misspelled. So this, of course, is already suspicious and reason enough to immediately leave the site and not enter your password. But the best check is to compare it to the real trustworthy site. How do you do that? Maybe you have the correct site bookmarked, or you remember the URL, or you can simply Google for Steam. And then you just need to go to the login page. And then when we find the same login page on the now clearly trustworthy site and compare the URL, you can now see that it's different. Simply switching back and forth between the page, you can clearly see that the domain is different. So now we know 100% this is a phishing page. And that's it. This is basically what you have to do. You simply look at the domain before you enter your password, and then you just need a way to quickly find the site you know is the safe site, or you remember the domain exactly and then compare it. Unfortunately, this seems a bit annoying to do, and you probably have a hard time making sure your parents learn to do this. So an easier way is to actually let the browser remember the password for a site. And you do not ever type in your own password, because now the browser checks the domain for you. The browser will only offer to autofill your password if the domain matches. So this is an easy way to never get phished. That's it. The domain is the only way you can figure out if the site you want to enter your password is the site you expected, the safe real site. Now, I could end this video, but for those people with more technical interest, I'd like to talk about a few other things. Check out this super advanced Steam phishing page. It looks very professional and trustworthy, but it asks us to log into Steam in a new window. So let's apply what we just learned. We know from earlier that the real Steam login page is steamcommunity.com. We can check the URL and it looks correct. So is this safe? No, this is just a very clever phishing page. This website is faking another window. It's very obvious here because this is a typical Windows window and I'm on Mac, but this could be really confusing to a lot of users. You really have to understand and know that this is your real browser window, this is the real URL bar, and all of this here can be fake. You can test it when you try to move the window around. It moves, but only within the page. For example, it cannot be moved over the actual browser window. So this is the actual URL of the site, which is obviously not the expected steamcommunity.com. So it is fake. That was pretty crazy, right? Next, let's tackle a technical question some of you probably have. Your defense technique depends on going to the phishing site and comparing the domain in the URL bar of the browser. So that means you already clicked and visited the malicious site. Doesn't that mean it's too late? Well, yes and no. So a lot of anti-phishing and security awareness training teaches that clicking on a link is already bad. They try to make malicious URLs sound very scary. And instead of clicking on them, you should do other checks. For example, check if the URL starts with HTTPS, or look at the domain of the link before clicking, or in the case where the link is not shown, hover over the link and check the URL there. But check the URL how? Now, it's very difficult to know which part is the domain. It's not nicely highlighted. And also, links can be faked. For example, in HTML emails, the displayed link can be different from the one that is actually there. Or seemingly trustworthy URL is redirecting you to a phishing site once you click. And when you do this hovering test, you might be wrong anyway. For example, Microsoft often sends mails with these weird domains. They look cryptic and fishy, and in fact, some people online believe it's phishing. But it's just a link tracker. It's Microsoft.com, so it's trustworthy, and it redirects to a safe site. But this advice is also not completely useless. You can apply all of that, but it only helps you to identify a phishing link early. It does not tell you if it's really trustworthy. There are lots of indicators if it's phishing, and it's great if you can reject the link early for being clearly phishing, but there is only one test to be sure it's not phishing, to be sure it's a safe site, and that is to check the URL bar in the browser before typing in your password. Actually, besides the domain, there's one more small test you can do if you click on a link and it asks you to log in. You can open another browser tab, go to the real website and make sure you are logged in. So if you're not logged in, log in now to the site you know is safe. And once you are clearly logged in, now click on the original link again. And if it still asks you for your username and password, it could be a phishing attempt and you should check the domain. Sometimes websites ask for a password again for additional security, so check the domain to make the final decision. But if it takes you now to some other content and doesn't ask you for the login again, you know 100% this link was not phishing. But clicking on malicious links is dangerous. Attackers could already hack you. Well, yes, but mostly no. Stop the fear-mongering about malicious websites, please. Let me explain why. First of all, it is very important that you use an up-to-date browser. In particular, that would be Firefox, Chrome or Chromium, Safari or Edge. They should also automatically update themselves, so you should not have to worry about that. So why is this important? Browsers are very, very complex pieces of software. It seems simple, just display a website here, but that is very complex. And complex software will always have programming mistakes, which an attacker might be able to exploit to install malware on your device. So to understand why people say that clicking on links is bad, we have to go back in time to the late 2000s to early 2010s. Browser exploit kits were very, very widespread. It was not uncommon that you visit a malicious website and it would exploit a vulnerability in your browser or an extension like ActiveX, Java applets or Flash to install malware on your computer. This was also called drive-by downloads. And once malware is on your computer, they could steal all your passwords. This was even a business model. As a black hat criminal hacker, you could rent or buy a collection of these vulnerabilities in so-called exploit kits. And it was a business model because it was affordable. A black hat criminal could pay a few hundred dollars per month to get access to an exploit kit that contained dozens of vulnerabilities. And back then, browsers were not automatically updated. New vulnerabilities constantly were found, and so this was a real threat. Now, over the years, browsers got a lot more secure, though vulnerabilities are still constantly found. But let me try to explain why it's different today. Here's, for example, the website of Zerodium in July 2021. They are an exploit broker. They buy vulnerabilities from security researchers and sell them to, for example, government agencies. And this is the price list of what they pay for an exploit. For a remote code execution, including local privilege escalation in Safari, Edge, or Firefox, they pay up to $100,000. And for Chrome, they even pay up to $500,000. Now, that Edge is also based on Chrome, I suspect this kind of changes now as well. So this means two things. First, I can guarantee you that there exists an exploit for your browser right now. A very powerful attacker could theoretically take over your device when you visit a malicious website. But then, how does this make sense with what I say you shouldn't be scared of clicking links? Well, the economics are different now. These exploits are very expensive. It's not affordable anymore by your random black hat hacker who tries to spread malware to thousands of people. So yes, there are still people being targeted by it, but you are probably not one of them. Let's be fair, you are too unimportant, so it's a threat you probably shouldn't worry about. And keeping the browser up to date is the most important defense you can do because it means older, cheaper exploits are not usable against you anymore. That's probably the best defense you have. But this also means if your company requires you to use an older browser like Internet Explorer because you have to access some internal intranet application, do not use this browser to visit anything else. For any other website, please use an up-to-date Chrome, Firefox, Safari, or Edge. Now, before I end this video, I briefly wanted to mention two-factor authentication. Oftentimes, two-factor authentication is hailed as a solution against phishing, but this is not really the case. It is true, two-factor authentication is an effective mean against the basic form of phishing. So when you enter your password into a phishing site, the password is stored and an attacker can use the password later to log in and take over your account. But a really advanced phishing page can still phish you. For example, the advanced Steam phishing site from earlier. When you have an account with two-factor authentication enabled, the site notices that and simply asks you for the code. So how can this work? Well, it's not different than when a friend sits at your PC and you tell him your username, password, and authentication code, and they type it in for you. That's what the phishing website does too. When you enter your credentials, in the background, the site already tries to log in to Steam, sees that the code is required, asks you for the code, and then you can supply it. Now the phishing site is logged into your Steam account and can do anything. This is definitely more technically advanced and requires a lot more coding skills, more than the basic phishing site, but it also is not magic. So two-factor authentication definitely can help against all this basic phishing stuff, but it's not bulletproof. So to summarize, it's good to look at various indications to recognize a phishing link early. Hovering over links, looking at the email where it's coming from, looking at obvious spelling mistakes, and so forth. But once you clicked, always keep in mind to look at the browser URL bar and make sure the domain, the part the browser highlights for you, matches the safe login site you know. And then you should be safe.